So with that said, let's have a big round of applause for tonight's guests and we'll get started. Thank you.
Let's kick things off with the blur reel.
Ready. This moment, my program is reactivated, and I am handing over command of all global field operations to you.
Introduce everybody while we're
yeah, of course. Going yeah, please feel free to fill all the silence.
All right. So, obviously, we're from Lur Studio. Next to me is Chris Bedrosian, CG Soup. Next to him is Oded Raz, who is Asset Supervisor, which I believe was you were a former professor here as well, right?
Yes.
What class did you teach?
Lighting.
Wow. I would have
I would have liked to take that class. So, you know.
Get my money's worth. So, and then here's Nitan Karnick, our comp lead. So we all together worked on Titanfall 2. Tonight, we want to talk to you about how Blur is evolving as well as Titanfall 2. Can I continue, or is that?
Yeah, please do. Yeah.
Okay. For those of you that don't know much about Blur, I forgot to introduce myself. So,
my name's Dan Akers, visual effects supervisor. So, as well. So.
He's our handler for tonight.
Yeah. I've been up since 5 a.m. So, yeah.
Flick stuff.
But so I want to talk to you about Blur. Blur's been around for 22 years. We are located in Culver City. We employ roughly 150 people. We develop content for film, visual effects, commercials, and special venue projects. The studio is helmed by Tim and Jen Miller. So I think in the past, Blur had a reputation of just doing great cinematics. As a company, Blur is quickly evolving. An example of this is really, I was talking with a CG soup at Blur named Darren Butler, and he said how in the past year there's been more changes in the last 12 months than the course of his 10-year career at Blur. So a lot is happening. You know, things are, you know, multiple avenues are, you know, we're kind of doing a lot of changes. We are combining visual effects work more so than ever before. We are utilizing plate photography to support our CG and vice versa. So this includes shooting primary plates to elements, all mixing and supporting our CG and plate photography. As a result, we are revamping our pipeline to support this infrastructure. This is part of the reason for Nitan, Oded, and myself coming on board. We all came from live action visual effects backgrounds. A great example of this process is our recent work on Titanfall 2. Titanfall 2 Become One is a commercial that blends live action photography with visual effects. Blur created a 90-second commercial for Titanfall 2 that helped launch the game. Directed by in-house director David Wilson, who guided the process. Dave himself is a homegrown Blur guy. He is started off as I think a scene assembler, generalist, moved his way up the ranks to CG soup, and then eventually became one of the top directors that I've ever worked with. So, and on top of that, we had our DP was Ken Sang, who did Deadpool. So, two great people to guide the vision, so you couldn't ask for a better combo. The concept of Titanfall 2 was driven by a throwback to Western movies, a man and his steed. And in this case, it was a mech or Titan. I love Westerns. I grew up with The Good, the Bad, the Ugly, High Plains Drifter. Combining a Western theme with mechs fighting in the forest doesn't get better than that. So that being said, let's play Titanfall 2 Become One.
From one fight on to the next, two outlaws ride with weapons flexed. One is quick, the other's tall. Together they'll kill them all. Bang, bang, they shot them down. Bang, bang, they hit the ground. Bang, bang, they torched the rest. Bang, bang, with lasers from their chest. Bang, bang, their kill counts rise. Bang, bang, their enemies die. Bang, bang, better hit the ground. Bang, bang, here's the rocket sound. Ooh, ooh, ooh. hit and cry, bang, bang. You're all about to die.
Talk a little bit more about the spot. Production began in the first week of August and completed on October 17th. Team made 43 shots in 11 weeks. Literally, we were shooting 10 days after it was awarded. It's pretty crazy, just the pace of the whole thing. We shot in four locations, Sequoia National Park, Lone Pine. There were three other locations, the sand dunes, burned out Sequoia area, as well as Alabama Hills. The Sequoia National Park, we were looking for a place that, just in terms of the choreography, we needed an open area where the mechs could fight. So where the trees were essentially on the perimeter. And so the battle took place in the middle. And a place called Balch Park had that. In Balch Park, if you've never been there, it's a beautiful place. It's about 3-4 hours away. It's well worth going out there. And the sequoias are just massive. Just to give you a little perspective of scale, this next image is of, that's me, Dave Wilson, Ken Sang, and Dennis, our line producer. I mean, so this is a stitch that took 4 stitches to put this tree together. And that's called the bonsai tree, and it's one of the oldest and biggest trees in Balch Park. So, and that was part of the charm of the whole spot, was maintaining that scale. And if you look at that, a mech is really about 18 to 20 feet, so it's about 3 times, you know, in height. And so it's important to preserve that scale in the commercial. So, and then on top of that, we went to the dunes as well, part of the opening sequence, and then went to Alabama Hills, sort of the fire portion where the campfire, and then we happened upon a place called Ash Hell, what we called Ash Hell, and this is a place where they did a control burn of the whole area of burning down the sequoias, and they do this just to control fires. But what was really interesting was the amount of ash that was on the ground, and every time you took a step, there'd just be this cloud that would come up. It was almost like being on the moon, and this is where like Dave and Ken Sang just had that vision. You know, what is this place? And they just knew that, you know, they could get this look of Ash Hell. So that was a pretty cool and impressive thing. So we had to create a photorealistic reproduction of the Sequoia Forest with a combination of scanned assets, photogrammetry, and LiDAR. Originally, we were only going to do 3 CG shots of the forest. And as you know, during production, things change quickly. And so it quadrupled that amount to 12, and on top of it, we nearly touched every shot and enhanced it. So quite a bit extra work within those 11 weeks, but it just had to be done. The key thing was to come back with that data from set and where we were able to recreate the forest. This included capturing reference, pan and tiles, HDR, LiDAR info, so that way we knew we could replicate it. The plan was to shoot empty background plates, and we would take the Titans, put in the Titans later in post. I think Ken thought I was a little crazy, you know, just shooting, waving his camera around, you know, of these empty plates, and you know, we put C-stands up for him to know his target, where to point the camera. What helped greatly was previs. The previs and layout team at Blur is awesome. One of the key reasons for our success. having a clear vision before even going on set. We had nearly a lockdown previs edit within those 10 days. And so these guys really hustled. And this really was our blueprint for everybody. Ken and Dave knew the pacing, the timing, as well as the camera directions to follow. So we had all the lens information that was necessary. So you've seen Titanfall in its completion. So what I want to present now is the previs, sort of our starting point and blueprint. So we can play that.
From one fight to the next, two outlaws ride with weapons flexed. One is quick, the other's tall. Together they'll kill them all. Bang, bang, they shut them down. Bang, bang, they hit the ground. Bang, bang, they nuked the rest. Bang, bang, with lasers from their chest. Counts rise, bang, bang, their enemies die. Bang, bang, bodies hit the ground. Bang, bang, here's a rocket sound.
So that's the previs, and you can see how close Dave matched the previs. Most shots were nearly 1-to-1. Most directors I know follow this formula. This is what kicked us off in the right direction. So right now, what I want to do is pass this to Oded, who will speak about the asset process.
So I joined Blur actually when these guys were about 3 to 4 weeks already into the project. Titanfall was my first one at Blur. This project had multiple challenges right out the back, seven original characters, 15 variations on top, lots of props, guns, knives. On top of that, this is not a typical Blur game cinematic that is usually all CG. This one had live action plates. The assets, the characters had to feel photoreal, had to match the photorealism of the plates. Those were pretty big challenges. And another one to achieve all that in such a short time, we had to improve the workflow and the communication between the asset department to the scene assembly, lighting, and compositing, and allow them to be a part of the look development process to basically make sure everything looks right, everything looks photoreal in each shot, everything is consistent. One of the things that we've done, let's start with this, actually. So this is kind of an overview of most of the characters. The originals are on the left, and then there are damage variations, color variations, material variations, just to create more variety. One of the things that we've done, and I'm going to use this character as an example, is to create tons of controls, lots of control mats for the compositing team to be able to help us with look dev. This is some of the reference for the hero pilot. And this is the hero pilot screen capture from Mari. This was the final result. And these are all the different control mats that we created to allow the compositing and the scene assembly teams to make sure everything looks photoreal, everything looks right in every angle and every shot. So you can see there's controls for everything. damage, materials, colors, the whole thing. A good example for that cooperation is the visor. The visor for the hero pilot was pretty complicated, and we definitely didn't have enough time to develop a proper shader that would look right in every shot and every lighting situation. So we started working with Nitan and Dan, and we basically provided them with lots and lots of different elements, and the final look of the visor was actually created in comp and not in asset, not in the shader.
Yeah, and it was great to have that speed and flexibility in the comp. I remember it was like a Friday night, and we had about like 4 hours to get like some iterations done for the visor. And a lot of times you could just work on a still frame and do a lot of things in Nuke and just, you know, put different grid patterns. The key was to kind of get the visor to look like there was like a screen on there, like some kind of display. So we tried different things with like a grid pattern, you know, a scan line pattern, you know, diagonal patterns, all kinds of dot matrix patterns. And, you know, we showed it to Dave and Dan, and we found out which one they liked the best. And then we then passed that back on to ODED's team, and they just took it and you know, propagated it throughout the show. So any shot with a close-up of the hero pilot, we could just plug in the same setup from that original look dev, and you know, you're on your way. You can move on to other things. So I think, yeah, when you're doing comp and you don't have much time on a commercial like this, you need to be like fast and iterative. But yeah, the grunge passes that Odette had provided. Odette, if you play clip number 3, you can kind of see, if you just loop this one, there's lots of subtle things that we're tweaking, and a lot of that stuff Odette and his team have built it into the shader and to the look of the pilot right out of the box. But sometimes you just need to push things a little bit further to give it that distressed feel and like the grunge, you know, little noise variation and all that stuff. It helps to, you know, bring that little 10% back into it.
Yeah, and I think just having that relationship between comp, Nitan, and ODED, that you guys were able to sort of feed that information back and forth, yeah, and just a lot quicker, and you know, we just needed that to turn things around. So it's a pipeline that we're just optimizing, and this is a new process of look deming that we're going to plan to do more of in the future.
Yeah. So we basically introduced a new tool for the asset, the character artists, and that tool is compositing. And I think now they're way more aware that they can use compositing, they can provide elements. Compositing can help them enhance the look, get to a photoreal level much quicker.
Yeah, right. Yeah, it's all about the collaboration.
And it's interesting because if you look at the video game, the visor is a little different. So it's, you know, what we were after was we felt we were making Titanfall to the film. So things needed to be match the plate and have that fidelity of being photoreal.
You want to just talk a little bit about scene assembly and your role?
Sure. So as Dan said, I'm Chris Pedrosi, and I'm the CG supervisor for this show. Traditionally at Blur, I've been with Blur for a little over 11 years. And when I started as a lighting and compositing artist, and scene assembly traditionally has involved a lot of the stuff that, you know, some of these guys do, except for maybe ODED, but back in the day when we were working on a lot of full CG projects, I would have the job of sort of like what a lot of you guys were doing, which is sort of asset management, reviewing and supervising some of the character production and the asset production. But a lot of that changed when these guys came in, which is really exciting, kind of demonstrates the new direction that Blur is going in with this project. So my roles transitioned away from a lot of these sort of production things into, multi-departmental production things, into something a little bit more specific with regard to lighting and compositing and being a conduit for stuff that's coming from ODED to the guys in compositing. And then making sure that everything we're doing on set comes into Blur, and that that we're able to reproduce those environments as like really, really high fidelity. So one of the first steps in that was going on set and shooting a lot of LiDAR, which is that light and dynamic range imaging And so we take a big scanner out there, and for each one of the major locations that we were on, we eventually ended up shooting a total of 63 different LiDAR scans, and these would get combined into 7 unique locations. And now what you're seeing here are the raw scans, and kind of populated around those edges, you'll see actually some of the shots from the show. And what we would do, one of the first things we did with the LiDAR data was take this and send it to a tracking company. And the LiDAR really helps them get a really solid track on some of that footage. Because when we get that back, we want the environment, we want environmental reference. We want to be able to open up the camera data and know, okay, well, there's where that tree was. And without the LiDAR data, what they do is they kind of throw in rough geometry proxies. And in some cases, the environments that those rough geo proxies reproduce aren't entirely accurate. So having the LiDAR data was really, really helpful to be able to get the camera data back and get started on the shots, but also understand with complete accuracy the topology of the environment and things like this, too, so that then our environment artists could get started right away, too. Once we were back in-house, let's close this guy out. So once we were back in-house, I got back down to business with more like traditional CG supervision stuff, which is producing the environments. the job of a scene assembler is pretty broad. Scene assemblers have modeled props, and textured props have modeled and lit environments, handle a lot of the rendering, and traditionally have also handled a lot of the compositing as well. On Titanfall, working with plates, there wasn't a whole ton of environment stuff, but there was some pretty impressive environment stuff. I'd like to, for example, use this shot as an example. Let's move on to the next image in the folder. There were actually a lot of supplementary rocks in the shot that we added after the fact, either for creative control or just because the environment didn't allow it, but we worked with Quixel mega scans, and I think some of these rocks were some of their mega scans, which were really, really helpful to have. We were able to drop them into the shot, and I guarantee you looked at the shot. I mean, the first time I saw it, actually, from the environment artist, I didn't realize that there were digital rocks in there. So go to the next, let's jump over to that movie file. So what you got here is the raw scan that came from our tracking company, and now we put it side by side with the LiDAR. So once that LiDAR is in the environment, we really have a really great geometry, approximation of what's in the environment. Here's the digital rocks added, and then the final composite with everything in there. And I think it's really, really, really super impressive shot.
So the LiDAR. It's one of our drone shots, right?
That's right.
Yeah, we shot on the Alexa, and then this one was shot on the Red.
Yep.
So really cool going through the saddle.
Yeah, man. Let's move on. One of the other things I would do on set, in the interest of reproducing this environment, which is really, really difficult, is to, between takes, basically I was running around with a camera, taking a bunch of reference photography. This reference photography was helpful for reproducing a lot of these props. Of course, texture photography, general reference for lighting, and shooting panoramas for pan and tiles, and these are like bracketed EXRs, or bracketed exposures, 360 degrees or 180 degrees, or generally areas of interest that we would end up, as you can see, we would reproduce into these really, these would end up like 15 or 20 or 30K sometimes, high dynamic range images, and these would be used and passed along to you guys in comp,
mm-hmm.
And along to our map painters as well for those guys to reproduce a lot of these environments digitally. This is another example of the Ash Hell pano, and you can see that was a 360 degree pano, but go to the next image. You could push in really, really close to this guy. I down-res this one, so we can't push in close to this one. But the JPEG itself was 100 megabytes. It's crazy. So that's all the on-set stuff. We would take that back with us, and then we actually began production in earnest in-house. So jump back to the last image, please. We have one environment artist, Simone Blanc, who in less than a month he was able to put together, basically assemble a forest environment. Now, there were no two shots that were really alike, so what we ended up doing is we had basically a collection of assets. And in total, we had over 800 environment assets, ferns and twigs and sticks and bushes and stuff like this, too. And what we would do is once we got the shots and the cameras and everything in there, with that LiDAR topology in place, we'd basically start to populate on top of that all of these elements. And eventually we had a couple of these fern elements that we would kick over to our cloth department. One of our cloth heads is here, Yuri. They would always get placed. They'd get placed, we'd kick them downstairs, and they'd come back up animated once the animation was in place and everything like that, too. We'll get to that in a second. So skip ahead. Again, I think these were some of the mega scans that we used. Just kind of take a look through some of these. They were great. A lot of these, I mean, you know, 500,000 polys, some as many as like 2 or 3 million polys each. Jump to 15. So you take a look at this guy. This kind of gives you an example of what our scene assembly artists were looking at once we were in the shots. And that is, actually, can I drive for a second? There you go. This thing. Let's do that. Cool. So this is what a lot of the scene assembly artists would end up looking at is an environment, basically all the CG stuff was in the foreground, everything behind it. That was what Nitant and his team did, and our matte painter as well. And here you can also see a pass of the animated ferns that were right around the base of that Titan getting hit. You can kind of see those ferns are a little bit higher fidelity as well. They had a much, much higher resolution. I think we hit somewhere like 30,000 polys on some of those. There may have been more, maybe 50 to 100. But we would only give them the section of that needed animation. And then, they'd kick it back up. Let's jump to the next image or the next video. And this gives you another example of what one of our scene assembly artists is looking at in the file. Really, only what needs to be there, because these files were really, really heavy. Sometimes took a half hour to open up, the files may have been small, but that's because you're seeing basically a lot of proxies in the environment there. We were proxying everything in; otherwise, each one of these files had hundreds of gigabytes. It was ridiculous. But that's what and we had various distribution patterns, ways of sort of distributing all of these elements into the scene. Let's move on. So one of the last things we do on set, of course, shoot our HDRIs. We shot a number of them because we were kind of constantly chasing the sunlight on this one. So every hour, I think we got out there, we shot a new HDRI. We effectively kind of distilled it down to the three most important ones, and these ones we used almost across the board. We had a daylight one, a one in direct sunlight, a one in shade, and then one in shade with a lot of bounce light. Now, a scene assembler's job is also to do a lot of lighting. And do all the lighting, and except for any of the relighting that you would do in the comp, but
very minimal.
Yeah. So this was one of the techniques that we scene assembler might use in the file for getting some of that cool dappled lighting. Of course, we didn't want to simulate actually having the trees there and passing light through it. So we would do sometimes we'd do like a scattered leaf system. Using some forest pack or something like that, and we'd kick some light through it. And this is an example. So here's that log shot, and that's the raw HDR, and then you have the lit version with the dappled lighting moving through it, and then those are these the environments combined. And there's one more pass here where we had a foreground element too. And this again gives you an example of what these are basically some of your raw renders coming out of our scene assembly. You can see again the ferns and such kind of floating and wiggling around down there at the bottom. Thanks to our great CFX team. While we're on the topic of some of the stuff that like a scene assembler at the studio might be asked to do, do some cool like lighting tricks. So for an example with this shot, we jump over this firelight quick time. So I'm just let this thing loop. This is something that Nitant might expect to see coming from a scene assembler. Which is kind of what you're seeing is an RGB pass. There's actually three different light setups happening on the robot rising in the foreground and the gun, and that gives Nitant the control to separate to get different effects. Basically, you have three different lights in there all baked into one render pass, and he can isolate it based on the red, green, or blue channel. What he would do is
the old shadow dancer pass.
Yeah, exactly. then you would sample the intensity from the plate, mm-hmm. and we would actually use that to help drive the intensity of the fire. But then we ended up having was it just gave them a lot more control. It's a really quick way. We like to use RGB passes because it really takes three passes. We could bake it down into one. And actually, we started doing a new thing too, RGBA pass too. So you actually get four passes in one. So you get a different. You can actually bake something different into the alpha channel, so you can use all four differently.
I'd like to really quick just kind of breeze over some of the just some of the effects stuff too. We really had a rock star effects team led by Joe Coleman, and those guys they had a couple of weeks of prep, but they did all of the CG effects in this in 3 weeks. And I'd like to really quick here just this, for example, is where they might start. This is what our effects artist might be looking at when he gets it. He's got a ground plane, he's got the animation, and we've got the cloth simulated ferns in there. So let's jump over to the next video there. And this is just a couple of passes of where effects artists might start doing some real flow stuff. Looks kind of silly, but you have to think that a lot of that stuff's on the ground is not going to be seen. What he's using to do is to generate some of the airborne particles, and then we can attach bits and pieces, twigs and things like that to that. And use that to drive any of a number of other little effects. Let's move on to the next video. And what you see here is just a variety of the passes that were coming from our FX team. And again, a lot of the populated environment elements too. Of course, across the board, we're using a lot of fume effects, thinking particles, real flow here or there, and all that stuff looks great. It's just one more, just some cool stuff to look at. And it goes without saying that I think the most impressive effect on it was Joe's explosion at the end of that. You remember that, and I'm gonna pass this off to Nita in a second, but I just wanted to say that explosion, we were rendering that with Houdini in Mantra, and that is because we could push an enormous amount of data through that as well. I have the number here. What was it? I don't have the number here, but it was like 50 billion voxels, in the billions of voxels. And what we've been doing at Blur now is traditionally kind of going through a max V-ray pipeline, and a lot of our special sort of fumey sort of effects are going to be coming into max now through the V-ray volume grid. Instead of doing that now, we've started to explore some deep compositing and then rendering through developing a new Houdini pipeline. So what we actually did, we rendered that explosion in Houdini, which is unheard of, because we would always, in cases like that, when you're mixing renderers, you have you get mad edges and things like this too that get in the way and just create trouble when you're trying to composite. Yeah. But we started to explore deep compositing. So I'd like to hand this off to Nitan.
Yeah, bridging the gap between effects and comp is always tricky, especially if you have to go through scene assembly. There's levels of things you have to think about. One of the main things is holdouts. So how many of you know what deep compositing is? Okay, so a few. It's basically so traditionally when you composite something, you have the A layer, the Titan, let's say in this case, and the forest behind it, so A over B. But what Deep allows you to do is to take, let's say, a render of a Titan and a render of three trees in a forest and just kind of merge them together using Deep, and Deep will intelligently put it where it belongs in 3D space because of the data that's in the Deep channel. So what you have is essentially more than one value for what's in front and what's in back. And so you can exploit that data to, your advantage. Odette, if you can play the last shot. So in this shot, Joe Coleman rendered this beautiful explosion, which is actually a mixture of, six different explosions?
10 explosions.
Yeah, he went nuts.
10 unique different effects to put this together.
He's like the Demolition Man.
It's crazy. First time we saw this, we were all mesmerized. I think we watched it on loop for about 5 minutes.
Yeah, and his first pass looked pretty incredible.
It's crazy.
So, as a compositor, whenever you see something like that, you're like, "Gimme, let me get at it,"
But I think it's funny enough. This was the last shot, the final. So
yeah,
if you remember
last minute.
That's the last one to go. So.
Yeah, but so we got all those passes, and what was really cool about the Deep in this one is when Joe did his original sim, it was hard to make it come very close to camera, and so it ended up being lower than the tallest tree in the scene. And so if you play clip three, we found out, we did a bit of a cheat where we kind of were able to deep transform the explosion in deep space, like towards camera, so that it kind of nestled into the tree a bit more. Mm-hmm. And so what was really cool about that is then you can get the shadow cast from the explosion onto the tree, and then the tree will then be illuminated by the explosion itself, which is, I think looked really cool in the final comp. Can you play the final comp again?
This one?
I guess, yeah.
And I think that was something that we kind of did on the last second night, clip. Right? We had to turn that around pretty quick.
Thanks.
I should add that even though we didn't render this with a V-Ray volume grid, we did still use an exported version from a V-Ray volume grid for this to do that illumination on the trees. So yeah. What we have is basically a very low-res version that we use for light and shadow casting that allowed for a lot of that interaction.
Yeah. With Deep, it's really important to know when to use it. And if you notice, like, this is the only shot we used Deep on, and that's because, you know, we definitely needed it with Yuri doing his sim on the trees and you know, Joe Coleman blowing things up and lighting having to iterate on their shaders and all that stuff. It was crucial to have that.
And the fact that we were making changes all the way up to the last night, if we had just rendered it normally, it would have gone another week.
Yeah, it's like trying to comp with one hand behind your back.
That's right. That actually, it allowed a lot of different departments to work independently, too. So we had a lot of departments working on this all at the same time. So we had our effects team, they were working on the effects. We had the cloth team, the guys were doing the, Yuri was animating the simulation of the trees moving. Nitat and his team were compositing. We had a matte painter that was painting out elements in the on the plate. And we could all work independently without needing to re-render each other's passes. We'd just slap it all together. When somebody had something new, it just sat right in. We could instantly get a new look and see how it all sat together, really, without a lot of redoing work.
Yeah.
It was great.
And, I mean, Joe Coleman and his team did a great job with a lot of the hero effects passes, but we also were able to use some practical effects, which is a lot of times it can give you that extra little bit that you need to make something look photoreal. Mm-hmm. And Dan, he likes to play with fire, so he made an excuse for him to use a flamethrower.
That's right.
To shoot some practical effects. Do you want to show the flamethrower?
Practical effects.
He invited me to come, but I couldn't make it, unfortunately. But I think this is pretty cool. It shows how BT was, you know, firing that flamethrower.
Yeah, we did an entire practical shoot for this, and we ended up in the valley, and it was a kind of an odd place, and did about a 4-hour pyro shoot with the flamethrower, different smaller explosions, muzzle flashes, and I think just having those elements and mixing them with the CG is kind of what helped take this to the next level.
But you didn't even stop there, man. Like, you just kept going. You went home, and then you shot your own Brillo pad, right?
That's right.
Steel wool?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, with Chris here.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah,
that was for a different show.
Oh, was it?
But, okay. That was a whole other evening.
Can we show that clip, too?
Do we have it? That was part of...
We needed to create some damage on the shoulder. And
that's right.
Basically, we... basically turning this Brillo pad and lighting it on fire, we would get that effect. So you can see here how...
It's fantastic.
Yeah, so, I mean, that's something that would take a lot of iterating on the effects end, and we can just take that off their shoulders, and using a P object pass, or we call it a OPP pass, we are able to just pin the damage, like the steel wool effect to his shoulder. And Brennick did a really great job of integrating that together and making it look singed, I think.
Yeah, so these are like kind of techniques we're going to use more in the future that's going to save a lot of time and money. And it's going to take pressure off different departments, especially effects. So we kind of meet in the middle. And so this is where we want to go.
Yeah. I did just want to talk about the matte painting as well.
Yeah.
So a couple of things that Chris pointed out. He was talking about how much on-set data that he was able to cover, you know, taking 360 panos, taking reference photos and all that stuff. And that was crucial in building our matte painting environment. So, I mean, a lot of times, like, we don't have the time to build out a full CG forest. So you kind of want to use 2D matte paintings wherever you can. And so I think we created 15 different matte paintings for this spot. Here's a breakdown of one of them. Max, our matte painter, very talented dude. He's a little overworked with 15 matte paintings, but I think he pulled it off.
he knocked it out of the park.
Yeah.
This is that ash hell sequence, basically where the burned out Sequoia riverbed, we went down there. And really, we shot the plate and basically extended from there. And Max did a hell of a job.
Yeah. And if you see, we're peppering in a lot of those little practical elements in the back there. It just kind of helps to sell everything.
Right. We shot our own ash and just different smoke elements. And Nitan and the guys integrated it pretty well.
Yeah.
Cool. I think this is a pretty unique project at Blur. The fact that we produced it, we had an in-house director, and we basically did it from start to finish all in 11 weeks. And I'm really proud of these guys. They worked really smart, and they didn't have to kill themselves. I mean, even though it was 11 weeks, I think the great part was just the communication between the departments. And we ended up, I think, doing no overtime, right?
No overtime.
We ended up working a 40-hour work week for 11 weeks. Till the last couple days, I have to be honest. So then it got a little, yeah. But other than that, I think the fact that just the passion of all the artists, they were really into this project. They really wanted to make this look great. And it was, you know, it's a unique experience when you've got an entire crew that's just so passionate. You're just like this one unified force together. And all the focus is just making these images as the best possible, and that's what happened on Titanfall 2. So it's a credit to all these guys.
Yeah.
I want to talk a little bit, just kind of close up with, talk about Blur's future. Currently, we're working on multiple game spots, commercials, and films. One of our in-house directors, Jeff Fowler, is working on the development of Sonic the Hedgehog. We're working on the development of the Goon as well. You may have seen that Kickstarter trailer. Also, we're doing a Netflix project. It's an anthology of animated shorts. And this is a collaboration between Tim Miller and David Fincher. So that's what we're going to be up against in the next year. Really exciting stuff. So we've got a lot of work to do. So I just want to say thanks for everything. This has been a great experience. It's my first time here at Gnomon, and I can't wait to do an actual tour of the school, and really appreciate you guys having us. I think we're going to do a little Q&A after this, and a gallery as well.
We're going to play the tour.
And we're going to do a tour of Blur, sort of an insider's perspective. And I believe, Chris, you
made it.
You directed it.
Yeah.
So this is Chris's directorial debut.
My Blur directorial.
So let's have a look at it.
Thank you.
I should mention, we also saw Colin James in there, who's also in the audience. He was our scene assembly lead, so I invite you to go talk to him as well if you want to get more information about the spot. And,
do you want to open it up to questions? Or?
Yeah, let's have some questions. And also, that was awesome, the video of the...
Can we do one more thing? We want to play the full length of the behind the scenes. Sorry.
Awesome. Yeah, let's do that. Questions here on the stage. Yeah? Perfect.
Thank you. Thanks, guys. I have a question about the effects in general at your studio. You mentioned Real Flow, Fume FX, and Houdini. Would you say Houdini is one of your main tools you work with for FX? That's what I'm...
Right now, that's definitely one of our go-tos. Yeah. And we're only just now starting to really make it a robust internal pipeline too. We used to kick a lot of stuff out of Houdini. Now we're finding better ways to integrate it, and we're definitely relying on it a lot more. Definitely, yeah.
Okay, we have another question here.
Hi guys, thanks for coming down. Really awesome, awesome stuff. I work in game development, so I'm kind of curious, what's the relationship like with these studios while you're working through this? You know, what kind of limitations do you have in terms of showing certain gameplay or maybe not showing gameplay that's in the game? You know, what's the creative freedom in that?
It's interesting. We were doing this for Respawn, who obviously produces Titanfall, and they gave us a lot of freedom. And I think as long as we were just presenting their stuff in the best way possible, I mean, the visor is a perfect example where, we were basically trying to create the Titanfall, the film, and they gave us a lot of latitude, and they just said, keep going, and it was a great back and forth relationship, but it was based on a lot on trust, and they trusted us early on.
Always with a lot of these game companies too, one of the very first interactions we have with them is they just send us all of their assets. So a lot of Lego Dead and his team spent their time working on assets that came directly from the in-game engine. So there's a good relationship there where there's a lot of sharing. And in many cases, too, when we finish things up, too, we usually end up sending back our final high-res assets. They appreciate having those, for future work.
And in some cases, you know, we're working with the game assets, but we'll also get their, you know, ZBrush files. Some of the, you know, they're, all of those are, you know, in-game stuff. All those in-game assets start as high-resolution models and baked down to game res. So sometimes they'll send us that stuff too. But the game assets are nice because they're fully UV'd and you have all that extra detail and information there. So, yeah.
Okay, next question is here. Hi, guys. It sounds like you guys did a great job working all together on, like, between the departments, starting out on such a short project, too. Mm-hmm. Do you guys have any tips for when you're working on a project that's such a tight deadline like that, and how you maybe work to prevent bottlenecks between your departments and the communication and workflow?
Daily touch bases.
Yeah, I'm a big believer in just the touch base, as Chris was saying, and having dailies, and just getting as much feedback to the artist as quickly as possible, and making sure that the, I think a key thing is like each department just communicating and crossing the lines, and just, it's, I like it when supervisors aren't just thinking about their own department, but they're thinking about one or two departments down the line, just to how it's going to affect things, and that's how you're really going to speed things up and optimize with, by the point like where a compositor gets an element, it is exactly what he's expecting, and it's not, he's not having to kick it back in the, and
I think, I think getting into the mindset of, you know, when you're working on an element, an asset, or anything else, going to the person next in line and asking them, how would it be best for me to hand it off to you? Mm-hmm. You know, what are your requirements? What are the things that can help you speed up the process? That kind of way of thinking. And another thing is there was a complete trust between the departments. We trusted each other to come through with the stuff that we had to produce. There were, no one was trying to micromanage other departments. And I think that's also a key thing to produce something like this in such a short schedule. You have to basically trust the other team to come through and let them do their job.
Yeah, I think to add to all that, I would just say FaceTime is what I'm a big proponent of. Just, you know, if it's a small team, you know, which this was, you know, there's no reason why you can't just go up to your lighter or, you know, your effects artist and be like, hey, I need this, or, you know, I could do without that.
Yeah, and it's not like a feature film where you've got, like, days to turn things around. I mean, you really have minutes, especially on the schedule. We're trying to keep things to an 8-hour day because I'm one of these guys that go home. I'm really about keeping guys fresh because I think the more tired these guys get, sometimes they're less efficient. So it's really about intensity within that 8 hours.
Perfect. And then question here? Yeah.
Hi. You lauded the previous team for their final output, and we saw the drastic difference between what they had come up with versus what the final product was. But I want to know, what is the goal of the previs? What is the most important things to capture during that, and what sort of is flexible versus what isn't flexible in terms of what you can do from that towards the final product?
Well, I think with previs, it's really a blueprint. I mean, you get all your lensing information, cameras, you know how it's going to move, you know even how the characters are going to perform at a certain point. So it's really the building blocks for the rest of the, just the rest of the departments and disciplines. So, and then you can take that, go on set, and the director knows what he's shooting, and he can follow it like a roadmap.
Darren Ross was part of that team. He's here. So if you want more information, you can talk to him about that too. But Dan's right. When we were out there, you know, you and Alex were literally running around with a sheet, all of those images printed out. It's like, here's the previs. We shot this on a 35, or we shot this on a 50, and just kind of one by one checking it off the list. And that's, you know, that was our schedule for shooting. Oh, that's right.
Right, and that's something that, you know, working with plates is fairly new to Blur, and then just bringing the plates in, trying to match them, doing a post-viz process, as Darren was talking about. You know, we had to do it for all the shots that weren't full CG, and that was something that was new, and that was like building blocks, but we got it done. So,
and that's, yeah. And that was part of the process of like I said, we had 43 shots on the entire show. We thought that maybe only three of them were going to be full CG. But when you're on set and you're shooting it, and maybe you don't have time to get the shot, or maybe you just
you get the footage back in the studio and it just isn't working the way you would plan for it to work.
Or you just fix it in post.
Well, that's when you put the check mark on it. Like, yeah. This is the fix it in post one.
Yeah.
There's only so much you can do with the plate footage before you say, well, this is unusable. And that's when, you know, what we thought was three shots turned into 12 that were full CG. And post-biz is part of that process of identifying which shots are we going to keep and which ones we have to, like, rebuild. And also gives animators a place to start, too. It allows us to drop in our final tracked cameras and just basically kickstart the rest of the process, too. It was an interesting thing. And it is a totally new thing that we've done at Blur, too. You know what I mean? It's just part of our evolution. And it was a really exciting process to work on that plate ingestion and tracking it and then watching it evolve and adapting our pipeline to that. So.
Okay, one more question.
Piggybacking on one of the questions somebody asked in the back about meeting the deadlines, do you guys use agile methodologies in any capacity to kind of keep the project on track? And second part is to manage the projects, do you guys use any tools like MS Project or Shotgun or anything like that?
Yeah, we use Shotgun extensively. And I like running a shot board as well, and it's part of the touch base in the morning where we list all the shots, kind of like where they are in the pipeline, what it needs to get final. We meet and we basically just talk about where these and what we need is get it to the next level. So these are constant, and it's all tracked in Shotgun. So, yeah.
And great production team, too, producers and coordinators, you know, always checking in on us and making sure things stay on track. Big shout out to those guys.
Yeah.
Yeah. Tiff Weber, Celine.
And next question.
And Savannah.
Yeah. Yeah. Invaluable.
Yay. Next question is here.
Hey guys, as a up-and-coming director regarding feature films, what are some ways that directors can interact with the VFX/CGI department that ensures the director has a good line of communication but isn't impeding the workflow? Because I know that can kind of be a conflict as crazy directors.
Do you want to take that one?
Oh, I'm sorry. I heard some of what you were saying. Advice for aspiring director and interacting with the VFX workflow? Right.
It was the opposite.
I think it's... Good.
Well, we'll both answer. But what's great about Dave, though, is that he came from the CG aspect, so he understood the process. And so it was great that he, we were all working as a team, and, you know, I would suggest, you know, we can do this, can't do that. And he understood the process, and that's from him being homegrown at Blur as a artist and then working his way through. Other directors sometimes don't have that understanding of like what it takes in the disciplines. It's something where if you're gonna get into the business as a director, you know, I think it's just kind of learning what it takes, everything from shooting on blue screen to the different disciplines in animation, learning these different avenues. And so I think the more educated you are, I think it just helps the VFX soup in the long run. You guys can kind of work in tandem together.
I think there can be a problem sometimes when you have... Oh, one of the things I liked about working with Dave was that he was pretty actually hands-off with a lot of the VFX and a lot of the technical stuff. So at Blur, really, we are story-driven. This is the most important thing to us is telling a good story. And it was great working with a director that, well, understood the VFX side of it, but also trusted us, and was able to look past the work in progress and not get too hands-on and not get too picky and start to split hairs on things. That was great. But as an aspiring director, I encourage you to know as much about the process as you can so you can understand the implications of some of the comments that you make too. You know what I mean? And that's what I mean is, so you might be throwing ideas out there without any like understanding of the kind of impact that'll have on a VFX team or the budget or the schedule, the amount of time. You know, Dave knew in and outs of it, but he was also hands off.
Excellent. Next question here.
Yeah, hi. I just have a question. Great presentation, by the way.
My question is,
you know, I'm completely new to VFX, and I just want to know, how do you guys keep track with all your digital assets? with the on production with like different departments?
We first of all, we have a great production team. We have an asset manager, Darren. I think he's here somewhere. And we also we keep communication going all the time. We meet once, at least once, sometimes twice a day. We go over all the assets. On this project, it was the three of us going over all the assets, the state of each asset, where it needs to be at the end of the day, at the end of the week, at the end of the next delivery, getting it ready for the next delivery, so on and so forth. So lots of communication and great production. That's kind of how we keep up with it.
Perfect.
But just about everything in the show is stored in Shotgun and accessible on local drives through Shotgun. And we're going through a big revamp to storage and sorting and versioning and all these things too, because it is a little clunky to keep track of all that stuff. But we're improving that process. And Shotgun is where it starts for us. And we can find everything through that and version it and like you said, follow, stay updated on that. Yeah.
On the 2D side of things, we also had a pretty extensive element library that we recently revamped and made it searchable, so if you wanted fog or sparks, you can kind of just type it into Shotgun and pull it up right there.
Yeah, that's something that just happened in the last few months where we expanded all the way up to 2,000 elements just to sort of help with that process of where we wouldn't have to wait on a sim on smoke or any sort of fire. Now it's in our library and we can find it within a couple minutes versus, you know, something that we'd have to recreate that might take days. So we're just trying to work a little smarter, and as a result, it helps us save time and money.
Yeah, the same thing has actually happened on the 3D side as well. We are using Shotgun to create a 3D library. So if we are looking for any asset that we've created before in the past couple of years, we can type it in Shotgun, and it's going to bring it up. If we look for a knife or a gun, it's going to bring all the guns and all the knives that Blur created in the past couple of years. Pretty handy.
Digital armory.
That sounds amazing. And a question here, yeah?
Yeah, I heard the budget was pretty tight in this one. Is it true that the whole VFX crew had to share a tent at base camp?
We cuddled to stay warm.
That is true. I think, is that Dave Wilson back there, I think?
Yeah, it is.
The director? It's true, we ended up staying. What saved us about an hour was camping out together, so it's true. Yeah, we all huddled together to stay warm.
Was that movie Without a Paddle? There's that scene.
Okay, and a question?
Hi, guys, big fans. Just want to say, in your professional opinion, when people are applying at Blur Studios, do you prefer specialist or to focus on one department, or do you like when people attempt to integrate themselves within all departments? And in that regards, what yourselves has given you the most value at Blur Studios? Like, what opinion, I guess?
I think, at least if you're talking about the department that I'm a part of, it's definitely, it's specific to the department, but our artists tend to do multiple things, so they don't just focus on modeling or texturing or shading. They're kind of responsible for all three, so they take an asset from start to finish. So yes, it's specific to asset creation, but it is a generalist in a way that you're responsible for all aspects of that asset.
I think with yeah, you're right. With character modeling, I don't think it really matters how well you can light. But when I'm looking at hiring somebody for scene assembly, which is a bit more of a, you know, like a broad scope thing, go both ways. I think if you're really good at something specific, then be really, really good at something specific and just be a knockout prop modeler. Because if we're looking for a knockout prop modeler, I'd rather you be really great at props than sort of good at a bunch of things. However, when I'm looking for scene assemblers or environment modelers, and they also happen to know effects and can do effects all right, and can light also, and also demonstrate that they have proficiencies in a couple of other things across the pipeline, Blur is sort of like a place where we all touch each other's work a little bit, and sometimes scene assemblers touching a character model, you know what I mean, when it's in his file, and sometimes a scene assembler's taking some effects and has to understand how to render effects or how that impacts like compositing. So
I think
if someone is really good at something, we're gonna use them.
Of course, yeah, yeah, so. Yeah. But yeah, so I think we appreciate when somebody can understands a lot of different parts of the process, but we're still definitely looking for somebody who is damn good at something.
Yeah, it definitely helps, like Dan was saying, to know how what you do affects the people downstream. And I guess I like to hit that home because as a compositor, I am literally downstream from everyone. So, yeah, if you're a lighting artist, you should definitely know how, you know, comp and modeling works and all that stuff. So it's all good.
Any more questions? Yes. We actually, guys, so the event we did in January that I mentioned earlier was all about, we had a panel from Blur, and they were talking about tips for demo reels, applying for studios, what to do, what not to do. So check that out. It's on our live stream. Who put their hand up?
Hi. I really like that tree branch that you showed. If you looked at the asset collection, you said it was something like 5 million polygons. Just really high poly count in general.
Oh, yeah.
Has it ever occurred to you that there might be some alternative techniques that could be used to render? Because I know that in Houdini you used voxels. And, you know, just judging by the time it takes to load these assets, has it ever occurred to just use something different?
I think we're always... one of the things I like about working at Blur is that it seems like with every new project, there's a new opportunity to try to explore different technologies. On a show like this, where it was so fast-paced, we really had to lean on some of the things that we knew already for things that we weren't really trying to not necessarily push that hard. But you know, for an environment model is an environment model when it came down to it for us. So we just didn't have time to explore some of the new technologies. But at the same time, you know, yes, we are always looking at new technologies for that sort of thing too. And that's why, for example, we were trying to prepare ourselves for scenarios like that. So when I was on set shooting a lot of these texture references and images of logs and things like that, kind of had it in the back of our mind that at some point I might be able to kick those over to Nitant and his team, and they could do some projection mapping stuff. You know, it's a wonderful technique for that and offers us way more flexibility than bringing in a high poly like rock or tree log into Max and rendering it. It just kind of stuck. So that we love sometimes that we can boast that we have a 5 million poly tree in a scene. And secretly hate ourselves because it took 3.5 hours to render the night before it was due. But yeah, we are always considering alternatives, and Blur is always looking at ways to grow. Yeah,
we always like better.
Yeah. Yeah.
Thank you. Oh, and another question.
Hi guys. I teach an advanced Houdini course here at Gnomon. And I wanted to ask you guys from a more teacher point of view, if there are specific things that you think that would help me as a teacher and then the students to prepare for a role as an effects artist.
In my experience, I love working with effects guys. Just as a compositor, it's really cool to see, like, you know, where they want to, especially with effects that are non-specific, like an explosion, everyone knows explosions look like, you know, what they look like. But if you're doing like some kind of plasma beam or something, that's always fun. You can be creative with that kind of stuff. But I find that what's really helpful is like when someone who's an effects artist in Houdini renders a bunch of passes, does something pretty cool with Nuke, you know, putting them together or using them in the way they intended it to be used, and then like passing it off to me and saying, hey, this is like for temperature control, or this is like meant to control lifespan of a particle or something. That's really cool because then I can now play with that and, you know, use it to my advantage instead of having to go back to that effects artist and have him re-render something. So it'd be good to have them know a little bit of Nuke, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, to add to that, it was one of the things that we did on Titanfall was really tried to provide as much downstream flexibility as we could. So I think to working in a production environment, it's not just to only accomplish your job, but try to make the jobs of everybody else easier. And I think that's one of the things I like about the people that we work with. We're all kind of always looking out for each other, so I think to have kind of a crew-minded mentality, sort of a community mentality with your people, to be willing to work with people,
every single day and give them the best work that you know you can provide and with as much flexibility as you can provide. And then, I mean, if you're looking specifically for tips and things that you should be working on, like if you're talking about explosions and stuff like that too, as much and as many different effects as you can provide, you know, because at the end of the day, if I'm hiring an effects guy, I'm just going to look at, well, how many cool explosions do you have on your reel, and like how badass does it look, and then how friendly are you, and how ready are you to just jump into the fray? Because I mean, sometimes these are be ready for long nights, a few.
That's awesome. Do we have any more questions? They keep popping up. We'll make this the last one, guys.
I just want to thank you guys for coming. You had a great presentation. The work is phenomenal.
Cheers.
And I wanted to ask you, how much do you use motion capture in your animations and in previs, and how much do you actually do hand animation?
I mean, from start to finish, I think. If you really want more information on that, I do recommend you talk to Darren Ross here in the front row. He's one of our animation supervisors at Blur. He does a lot of layout. We do like to...
And puppets.
We rely on motion capture a lot. At the old Blur studio, when we were in the Venice location, we actually had an on-stage or an on-site mocap studio. We rely on it from layout to anim, and it's actually something of a luxury to get to do some keyframe animation for some of the kind of toonier, more stylized stuff. But we love mocap, and in the interest of Blur pushing and improving, we're always exploring new technologies with regard to that too. So we worked on a Rainbow Six thing where we did some hand motion capture. We actually did like down to the hand articulation stuff, and facial. We're always exploring new performance capture with the facial as well, and we're exploring a lot of new cool technologies with that too. You saw the Angela Bassett thing, which is in the Blur reel. That was one of the projects I supervised, and that was one of the first times Blur used a DI4D technology, which actually doesn't use any trackers on the face. It's just an array of cameras that they're all shooting at the same time, and it creates a reproduction of that. So, yeah, we lean on motion capture very, very heavily. But there's always cleanup too. I mean, it's never one-to-one. There's a lot of struggling. But I love that we use it all the way from the start. We're doing mocap for our previs. I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, Darren, but I think in some cases, some of that previs mocap actually filters into actual proper animation in earnest, right? Yeah. I know we're doing like camera capture stuff, like playing with like layout and VR and things like this too. So there's a lot of new exciting stuff coming down the pipe. Cool.
Awesome. Would we be able to play your studio reel one more time finish up?
Ready. Moment, my program is reactivated, and I am handing over command of all global field operations to you.